Falguni, as we are starting, if you could introduce yourself, your husband, and what you've been doing in Divine for the past 14 years.
Well, I am Falguni Mehta. My husband, Hiren Mehta, we are here. And God brought us here, and we really didn't know. We had a different purpose to come here. Our purpose was healing for our situations in life and family.
Yeah.
And somebody guided us that you will be really blessed by coming here.
Yeah.
But after we came down here, we realized that God has a different purpose to bring us here. And, you know, God will invest in a person so that He can spread out His kingdom through that person.
Yeah.
So He anoints us so that ultimately His kingdom can spread.
Yeah.
So that's what He did. And in whatever little ways, so reaching out to other souls who are also lost and who come down here seeking solace and seeking His presence and comfort. So we, in our little ways, we try to help them out.
So you've been ministering for the past 14 years in Divine?
No, not 14 years. I started in a very small, in a small way. We started with little children's section, and slowly and steadily, you know, step by step, things proceeded more and more, and then came up to full-fledged ministry.
So before we go into your testimony, Falguni, I just want to understand what kind of a background that you come from. So could you share a little bit about your childhood? How was, your parents?
So we are basically from Gujarati family.
Yeah.
And if you've known Gujaratis, you know, our of course, there are different types of, you know, Gujarati communities.
Mm.
I was a very strong family bonded people.
Okay.
And, you know, parents are such, they live for their family.
Mm.
Yeah. You know, so especially I've seen my parents, my family, my uncles and all.
Mm.
For them, job. Not job in the sense, their business and their family, their children. That's all their world is all about, you know. And so they have nothing besides. So no vices, no, you know, sitting out with friends. No, it's only you and your family. So that bonding was very strong, very, very strong, right? And respecting our grandparents and all our uncles and aunts. We brought up in a joint family system. So I had a good childhood, very nice, pleasant childhood. Of course, we all have our little setbacks in life. And as a child, I had some complexes.
Okay.
Yeah. And of course, later, when I came down to the Lord, I realized these are the real inherent deep wounds of my life.
Yeah.
But that over the years, the Spirit of God and the Word of God helped me heal all of those areas. So I have no complaints, and in fact, I have very good memories of my childhood. I have I'm the eldest, and I have younger siblings. I have a younger sister and a younger brother, and we bonded so well that we don't need anyone else. We three are enough as friends, and wherever we would, you know, in the afternoon time, we want to go in for a movie. Come on, let's take the car and go for a movie. And my brother was 10 years younger to me. But, you know, as he grew, same height, body. So we all three looked as if we are just the same. You know,
yeah.
We are all friends and that
yeah.
way. And so everybody in the, even in our society, these three siblings, they are just made for each other. It's like that. And truly till date, I miss those childhood days. I really, sometimes I even ponder and think, I said, you know, I just hope I get them back, you know. You sometimes really want them back. My brother, he got his PR to Canada, so I'd been home. And I was, we all three were reflecting what good years we spent, happy moments that we spent with each other. And now we're in different parts of the world. Really don't know how life really takes us. No?
And I know that you were not born into a Catholic Christian family.
No.
So did you have any kind of religious formation?
Regarding?
Yeah. What was your outlook towards God?
Yeah, family has been very, all the time, very religious. So,
religious in what sense?
They are morning prayers and, you know, going down to the temple and, you know, because for us, we have no other source of entertainment as such.
Mm.
Only maybe once in a while a movie or a restaurant outing or something. So, we will not go, parents will take us to temples.
So it was a social event.
Social event. Then we have to go down to temples and all. And we enjoyed. My parents are very much religiously, inclined.
Mm.
So we children were brought up in that setup. And yes, from childhood, I always had a, you know, yearning. And, you know, we were, I was into Bal Vikas classes. My daddy is a very strong believer of Satya Sai Baba. Okay, so there is something called, you know how we have catechism? Mm. There they have something called Bal Vikas classes.
Okay.
So I used to go for that. And so those moral values, all of that. Mm. So that was always there. Mm. That was always. And my dad was he's a very strong principled man.
Okay.
So looking at him, mm. I got some, you know, some things about how to deal with money. Mm. How should a lady be dressed? Mm. You know, all those things that my dad would tell he's sown those seeds in me.
And he was also into business.
Yeah, very much into business. Very much. Yeah, Gujaratis, we are all business people. We don't go in for jobs.
Yeah.
So very business minded. So and as when I grew up also, I was helping him out in his business, whatever little way. So I always saw his dealings was so, you know, he was
clean.
Very clean businessman. Because he says, if a person cannot handle finances well,
mm.
if he is not faithful in money,
mm.
that man is not a good man. That you cannot count that person for his character.
Mm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
And ultimately he says, whether you have money or not, if you have your character, everything counts.
Mm.
So I actually don't know how, you know, marriages happen in Gujarati families.
Yeah.
But as a girl, as you were growing up, did you have any expectation about marriage? What were your dreams about marriage?
You know, we have, of course, in our families, generally it is arranged marriage.
Okay.
Okay. It's like love is like very rare possibility.
So you didn't even try as you were growing up?
No. Maybe... you know, our family setup was so secured,
yeah.
Can't even think of it. You can't think of it, you know. So, you know, we are brought up in a very, very secured atmosphere. So, it's just out of question.
Mm.
So, anyways, so proposals come across and so I saw many. And, well, as a...
Did you have any expectation or a dream about the guy?
I cannot word it out that way.
Yeah.
But we should gel well, and we should be able to understand each other well.
Mm.
But that time when you are going in for marriage, actually you really don't know what life has in store for you.
Yeah.
And you might be thinking so many things, but things turn up very differently.
Yeah.
Yeah? So maybe that time we are not so matured enough to even really evaluate whether what's really going to come up in life.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's only later when I, after getting married and all, I really understood that life is, you know, marriage is not a bed of roses at all. You know, it's not at all.
It will be an eye-opener for all the young people who are listening, right?
True, true. Please, let us not live in a, you know, made-to-do world wherein we are thinking that, you know, things... Because today, media puts it up in such a way that marriage is all about love, love, love. It's not that.
Yeah.
You have to face the hard realities of life.
Mm.
Your love will be tested in marriage.
In marriage, there are many things that will be tested.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how much can you be, you know, understanding, or how much you're ready to compromise, or how much you're ready to let go.
Mm.
You know, because at many ends, especially our egos and having it our way, it really becomes such a big block in having the love bond going stronger. Because ego will be the first thing that will hit that love bond. Because you get stubborn, you know, and where pride comes, there cannot be love.
Sure.
So you realized all this after you got married.
Yes.
So at that time you had
no
sense of these things.
Because my family also, we had, we saw that, you know, parents, yes, they do have a little issues and all. But that generation was also a little different.
Yeah.
Every generation has its own... you know, differences. That generation, as I understand, my mom and my dad, they just saw the photo, or maybe, you know, at some marriage, oh, that is the boy, and they just get married.
Yeah.
But our generation, at least we were allowed to meet and we go out for courtship and all that. So
you did all that with your husband.
Yes,
so
yes,
how did it happen?
Yeah, it was an arranged marriage, and then we had a courtship period, and so there was engagement and all that. So it was good. We had our little differences there and also.
But during the courtship, you mean?
Yeah, that is natural. That is natural, you know.
Yeah.
Though you try to put up the best of yourself,
yeah,
you always have some weaknesses.
Yeah.
So that was natural. But however, everything went through.
Mm.
I really didn't know what life had in store for me.
Mm.
Yeah. And nor me nor my husband could ever imagine that life is going to take such deep turns, and how we are going to go through the real lows of life. But
so,
we are happy about it.
So, Falguni, before we go on to your married life, if you could share a little bit about your association with ISKCON.
My mom is a very, she's a devotional singer. So,
okay.
She always wanted me to, as her daughter, to, continue this legacy of singing.
Mm.
So, she put me up, and I always was very passionate about music. So, I started doing my music.
Mm.
And my classes were in the same area where this new temple, ISKCON temple, came up. And so I started becoming a regular visitor to this temple.
Mm.
I got very much fascinated by the temple, and I became every day involved in the temple activities.
Mm.
So my goal of life was that, then my goal of life was that I want to commit my life to ISKCON.
Yeah.
ISKCON, Hare Krishna movement.
Okay.
And I became so much involved in all that. And I wanted to, there is something called initiation ceremony there. And I so much wanted me to be there.
Mm.
But I don't know, it just didn't take place.
Mm.
My initiation didn't take place.
Mm.
But today I understand God had a different plan for my life,
Yeah.
He wanted me to come to Catholicism.
What a strange way.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Way God works,
yeah,
right?
God works. And so then, after my, when I finished my college and my studies.
Yeah.
Then parents looking out for the groom and all.
Yeah.
And so then get married.
Yeah.
And how it generally goes.
Yeah.
So then I got married.
Yeah.
In 95 I got married.
Okay.
95 I got married.
Yeah.
And so I was always thinking that, I'm very religious, I'm very spiritual.
Yeah.
All that I was thinking. And because I have my base of ISKCON, my ISKCON foundation is there.
Yeah.
But when it came to marriage, things didn't work out. So
what did not work out, Falguni, if you could be a little more elaborate?
My hubby is the only child of his parents.
Okay.
So, he had some, I had some issues with my in-laws.
Cool. Yeah.
Okay. And because of those issues, our relationships got strained.
Mm.
And me and my husband also, though we had a very good, strong bonding,
mm,
but, when it comes to little, these petty matters that can take up, it can become a bigger proportion in your life.
Yeah.
And if you don't really work on it,
yeah,
it can take the whole of you.
Sure.
Yeah. And so anger and bitterness and all that, and that totally spoiled my peace of mind. And in your anger, you don't take right, sane decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I understand you should never take a decision when you're angry. Because that's not from the Lord. It's not according to the plan of God. It is your pride that is speaking, or your wounds that are, asking, or the evil one trying to do something, trying to play havoc in your life.
So this scenario is actually very much prevalent in the Indian communities, right? Where the in-laws play a major role in married life. I've seen it in my parents' family also, that, the in-laws come and take decisions for the husband and wife, and it invariably does not work out.
Yeah.
So the problem with you in your situation was not so much with your husband, but with the surrounding.
Yes. Yes. And it's very, all those viewers who are listening, they should know. And we as families, our first priority should be to our spouse.
Sure.
And all the other members,
mm,
yes, they do have a role. But there should be a boundary line. You should know where they stand. You should know where you stand. And today, our Indian community or Indian society is such that we generally, not that we don't have to respect them. Obviously, we have to respect them.
Mm.
But then sometimes they can really interfere in the relationship, and that can really...
And they might not necessarily understand the dynamic of how a husband and wife relationship work. Every husband and wife relationship is so unique, right?
Very true, very true.
Yeah. And you know why I feel so strongly about this, Falguni, is because my family also was distorted because of in-laws interference. And I feel, you know, the spousal relationship is so sacred that nobody can come into the inner space and infringe it.
True, true, very true.
So, you know, what was the decision that you made when you were angry?
You know, these little petty fights and all and arguments. And then I thought maybe just for a little while, like go back home.
Mm.
But it was only after I went back home that, you know, things took a very different turn. He started having a lot of other business problems and financial issues and all of that. And so I stayed back home. And
In your home, you mean?
In my home, in my parents' house. And I was thinking that maybe he'll come to pick me up. And he thought I'll go back. And, you know, that's where we think that what we are doing is right. Huh? Not understanding where we are missing out on understanding each other. You know, we always think that the other person should understand me rather than we trying to understand that person.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, we both stayed back in our own houses, and then things were, at his end, became very difficult. So, family and all, we all thought, at that time, it seemed that this is the best decision to separate from each other. So, I filed the divorce papers and all that. That was a very painful phase for me.
This was after you left in the 6 months.
After I left from the 6 months.
Just before you go ahead, Falguni, you know, in today's world, there is a lot of feminist influence in the girls who are growing up. Like, you know, a small thing that the husband man says, they always take it as a thing that the man is trying to dominate. And they take very, very hasty decisions which eventually destroys many marriages. So would you like to comment on that particular thing? Do you see a connection to what you did?
True.
Yes, we do take those haste decisions because we think we also need to have a say. Nobody can ever dominate me.
Yeah.
And since I've also left my parents, he also needs to take a decision. You know, he should take a stand for me.
Yeah.
All of those things, yes, they do. But, you know, separation, divorce, having it our way is never a solution.
Mm.
It is never, and it can never be a solution. It's only in giving in that we really gain life.
Unless the only exception would be where the husband is abusing or physically abusing the wife.
There are many cases wherein, you know, because, you know, every person is so unique.
Mm.
He has a baggage of his own,
yeah,
of the past wounds and hurts.
Yeah.
After I have known the Lord, I have understood why a person is behaving in a particular manner. There is a reason behind it. He is not healed of many wounds of his past. And that's why he is behaving in a particular... If we start understanding that aspect and try to understand even yourself, things become much more easier and simpler and to really face them and go the right way.
So when you took the decision to file for divorce, were both the families were for it or they were trying to convince you otherwise?
My family, of course, was for it. Yeah, they did not want it, obviously. But the situation demanded so, and he was in a real bad critical condition. So it was during that separation years that he got sick.
Okay.
And I was unaware about all that. And we had many events happening during those times, you know. He had a lot of other legal matters also coming up in his life. And so when it comes to legal matters, no, people want to take a back seat. They don't want any ways to, you know, us to help. And so he was really isolated with all his problems. And my family here with divorce and all. And so divorce went along for 4 years. But I, somewhere deep within my heart, I had filed the divorce, but I was thinking to myself, will I be able to settle with someone else? Or is any other man meant for me? Or am I meant for any other person? And I never could digest that concept. Maybe because of the teachings of our parents or something. I really don't know where I can place myself there.
One second.
And so after when actually divorce was coming through and it came through, was I took a decision to go back. It was a very strong decision. And today if I reflect back, I believe it was inspired by the Lord. Though many people feel it was a foolish decision because he was ill then, you know, he was unwell then. And
what happened to him?
He got afflicted by some major physical sickness, a central nervous problem. It's an autoimmune disorder, and which affects the brain and the spinal cord, the central nervous system, and it can affect the multiple organs of the body. That time when I came to know, I didn't know it was that bad, and I didn't know it can go so bad. That time his walking was a little wobbly, and I really don't know how gray was it. I really didn't have any idea because we were not, I didn't know where he was and I didn't have details about him. So since we were not on communicating levels, I really didn't know about all that. But that sickness is known as multiple sclerosis.
So was the cause of the sickness, did it have anything to do with the pressure that he was undergoing with the legality?
Yes, I believe it. Because today stress is a big killer.
Yeah.
All said and done, all our sicknesses have, there is a lot of influence of stress and, in our mind. Yeah. Because our mind plays on our body. And
yeah.
All. Yeah. So, though medically people say that there is no, you cannot actually say what is the real cause.
Yeah.
But people in MS cases, they say, please slow down your life. Yeah. So, which means stress is... has been one of the causes, major causes for this happening.
So this is interesting, Falguni. So after you separated, after the first 6 months, you didn't want to go, but your husband was all well.
Yeah.
But now he's not well and you made a decision to go back to him.
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know how to tell you that.
Yeah.
But I just knew that I can't be on my own, and there was some inner voice telling me, I need to go back. I need to be by his side. He needs me more than anybody else now. When I came to know of his sickness, so I thought if I can't stand by him now, then no point in me getting married to him. So
at this time, divorce papers had come, and if you had signed it, you would have been divorced.
In fact, everything was done. The ex parte judgment was done.
Okay.
Everything was done.
So
it was
they had given you divorce.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, the judge had told that, it is all clear because the matter was in such a way that I was appearing in the court. He could not appear because of the other legal matters.
Oh.
So he could not have. So it was like an ex parte judgment.
Okay.
Ex parte judgment means when the other person doesn't turn up. So you get your judgment, you get your decree, in that sense. So things were moving in that end.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what happened? So you went back to your in-laws' place?
I came back to him. Somehow or the other, I got details as to where he was as I came back to him. And then I stayed on with him.
Was he staying with his...
He was very much with his parents. So we both stayed together. We all stayed together. Still, we had these issues with in-laws and all. But now he had a very strong say that, she's come back. And now I don't want history repeating. So we need to really take care. And, she's come back for me.
Yeah.
So we need to see to it. So, but after I came back, in 6 months' time, he got... more worse regarding his physical condition. So till then he was walking. He could go do his daily activities. He could go to the washroom. And it was okay. He could live an independent life. But in a way, in a little restrictive manner. But after 6 months after I came back, in December 2000, he got this fatal relapse of multiple sclerosis. And below his chest line, he lost total muscle power, sensory power, control over his bowel movements. He got bedridden. And it was only then that I realized that, life is not what I expected it to, be.
Yeah.
And then you face the hard realities of life. And we were at Leelavati Hospital in Bombay. And we had the, you know, Leelavati Hospital that is, you know, next to the sea. It's at the shore. So every evening I would see the, you know, just look into the sea and, you know, the sun setting. And then I feel, where is the horizon of my life, you know. And I had only questions and questions to which I had no answers.
Did you pray to your deities that you had?
I did. But therein something I need to mention. Just, you know, the room where we were, if you watch opposite that, you know, there is, we have the Mount Mary Church there. Not Mount Mary. Saint Michael.
The Archangel.
At Mahim, there is a church, very famous, Mother Mary's novena is going on. It's a very famous church.
Okay.
So, all the sisters in the hospital are Keralites.
Okay. Yeah.
And most of them are Catholics. So, they told me, pray to Our Lady. So that's where I started praying. And just behind the hospital is Mount Carmel Church. So every time I go there, I would be standing, I would stand below the you know, deity, the statue of our Lord. And then I said, I know that you are a healer. So why don't you come and heal my husband?
I mean, someone told you that God would heal?
No. Yeah. I knew that as a child, I have read little about Jesus.
Okay.
So I know he has healed the blind. He has raised the dead man alive.
Okay.
So I said, so why don't you come and heal him? So every night, I used to place a chair next to my husband's bed. And I would tell him, you know, so every time I go down, I would visit the church. And I would tell him, so see, I'm going to place a chair next to my husband. So in the night, you can come, be seated there and heal my husband. So in my little innocence, I don't know what I started praying in such a manner. And every day, for 4.5 months, we were at the hospital. He was so bad. And they put him up on steroids and that really he became obese and so many other complications that happened with steroids and all. And that's where our real struggle started. Then we started with a lot of other alternative medicines, everything, but nothing worked out. So he remained in that same. There were like, you know, in two, three months, there would be a little high, he would get better. Then again, there's a relapse. He'll get, you know, so his chart would be, you know, going up and down, up and down. In that, so in 2003, we had some major other business issues, and we had to actually leave our house. That's where all our life took a different turn for us, because by then I had attended one prayer meet, one Christian prayer meet, and one brother was in contact with me. On and off, he will call me.
Catholic?
Not a Catholic.
Okay.
When we had this major issue regarding our business problems coming up, I don't know what inspired me to take that decision that we will live life on our own now. Me and my husband, come what may, however life, you know, whatever struggles I have to face, but I will handle him. You know, I will take care of him. So I told my in-laws went their way. And we both took life, you know, we just went on our own. And that's where we were, you know, some people were helping us out, some friends were helping us out and all. And then we reached one place wherein we were just left, it was like one small investment house. And at the far end of Mumbai city, where there is no range, no phone calls coming. And that time in 2003, we had this Orange mobile and all connection. And we were just left there and we both were wondering now what to do with life. You know, how long can we pull along ourselves further like this? Because we can't be moving every 5 days to somebody else's house. So how do we go along like this? And what about our daily needs? What about our future? So we both had come to such a point when we thought that no point continuing life like this. Rather end your life. When we were thinking like this, we get a phone call. When there is no range, we get a phone call from that same brother who
the
was
in Pentecostal
the Pentecostal brother.
Yeah.
So, this itself is a testimony that God can reach out to you.
Even where there is no network.
Yeah, there is no, there is just no network, but His network is always there. Yeah. You always are in His network. So He will reach, He will go to any extent to reach out to you. And so this brother comes and tells me that, and I told him my life is in a real bad shape now. So he said, don't worry, we still have someone who can lift us up and things like that. And so he assured me, why don't you come and meet our pastor? So when he told me that, I had some different intentions in my mind, because I knew he was, you know, attached to the rosary, to the Rotary Club. And so my intention was that, because I was doing some little business that time, so I thought maybe he can give me some contacts to expand my business. So at least somewhere I have some go. But though I had that intention, God had a different intention. I went down to meet this pastor, and this pastor said that God is going to use you, and you are going through, trials. And the way, when I explained him the struggles that I was going through and how I was, it was real difficult moments for me. He's saying, you stood by your husband even in these moments of trials. He's saying that itself is very much, you know, God is pleased with anybody who stands by this covenant. So he really honors. If you honor His word, He will honor you. And so the pastor said, God will honor you. God has to honor you because you have stood by His word. And I never understood it. What was he trying to say that time? But he's saying, no. The Bible teaches us that what God has united, let nothing separate it. Be it trial or tribulation or even struggles or even hunger or persecution. When God has united you together, you should not leave your husband. And you have stood by him in his sickness. So God is going to honor you. And so he sent across a couple to us. And, you know, this couple said that, you know, they gave us a lot of hope. And I started visiting this prayer meet on and off. And every time I would go for that prayer meet, I felt as if God really is reading me. He knows where I stand. He knows my situation. And He really knows where to talk to me, how to deliver the message. So I thought, how does the pastor read my mind? How does the pastor read my life? And not understanding, God can really meet you where you stand. So even in your failures, even in your disappointments, you know, when you're discouraged, He can lift you up. So that's how I saw that there is something in this. There is something in this. And then I went and started. This pastor invited Pastor Benny Hinn. So he was the one who hosted Pastor Benny Hinn. So he told me, why don't you come with your husband? There are many healings.
Yeah.
So me and my husband went for that crusade.
Yeah.
In that crusade, something happened. I really don't know. I can't place my finger what happened. But something happened. I was really touched by the Spirit there. There was praise and worship going on. And in that praise and worship, they were singing Hallelujah. And I didn't know what is Hallelujah. But I just was led to praise God along with everyone, and tears rolling down my cheeks. And I'm just up in arms and, you know, gazing into the sky and, you know, into the stars, because it was an open air crusade and it was evening time, you know. And I, as if I was trying to find God, you know, up in the sky somewhere. And that Hallelujah was so strong, and it just was there. It got, you know, as if it got sealed in my spirit, you know. And even after I went back home, that Hallelujah wouldn't leave me. That tune and that melody wouldn't leave me. And life went on like this for 1 or 2 months, and we were reading the Bible. That couple was helping us out to understand more of the word and all that. Then one day this couple came down to us, and I was fasting that day. That is the 11th day fast called the Ekadashi fast. And that day that couple, he's saying, you need to choose between, because that time I was following Krishna, ISKCON.
Yeah, yeah.
You need to choose between Christ and Krishna. So I said, how can he talk to me like this?
I was about to ask you that question. Like, for most of the Hindus, it's not difficult for them to accept Christ as one of the many gods. but to accept Him as the God.
The God, yeah. So I was, for me, it was one more God amongst all the other gods that we have.
Yeah.
So what's the harm if I worship Krishna and I worship Sai Baba and then I worship even Jesus. So it's okay.
Yeah.
But that day this person told me, no, you need to choose.
Mm.
I said, this is not right.
Mm.
And he can't tell me, he can't question my faith. Who is he to question my beliefs?
Mm.
And I have been, I have all along from childhood, I have been praying to Krishna. So why should I, you know, give up on Krishna for Christ? You know, like that.
Yeah.
And so then, but after he left, I had to go down to my mom's house and I was on the train and I was all alone in that first class compartment.
Mm.
And there was a struggle in my soul. And I started crying. I don't know why. My soul started hankering to know who God is.
Mm.
And so I asked, my soul cried out. I said, God, where are you?
Mm.
Who are you?
Mm.
You know, people have given you so many names. But why should I call you by some name? If you are my God and if you are my Father, you are my Creator, don't I have the right to know who you are? So why don't you reveal yourself to me? And I said, I'm not going to call you, henceforward, I won't call you by any name. I just call you as my God and my Father and my, as a soul, you know, ek atma paramatma ko janna chahta hai. So I really cried so bitterly during that entire journey. And then I forgot about that prayer. I went down for my daily work and all that. But that's where life took a different turn. You know, when you read in the Bible, Philip says, show me the Father and I will be satisfied.
Mm.
Show us the Father. So,
yes.
In some way, I also prayed the same prayer.
Mm.
Show me the Father and I will be satisfied. So that's what I prayed. I just want to see you. I want to know who you are. And it was only after that in 15 days time, some major event happened in my life. Was some family friend had some other vengeance against some other family members because of some business dealings which didn't go well.
Mm.
He put some case against me and all that. And
against you?
Against me.
Mm.
He dragged my name in,
okay.
in the case and all. And so false accusations and all of that. And a young girl with nobody to support her, husband being like this. So we are so vulnerable, we really, and when it comes to legalities, we are not trained to know what is, you know, how to handle these matters.
Yeah.
So things took such a different turn that this couple told me that, you know, I feel you cannot handle all this. You just need to move out from Bombay now. Otherwise, they will be like, you know, wicked wolves trying to tear you apart. So at that time, I met one person and he said, you know, go, just leave Bombay and for some time, just go somewhere. And I was wondering where to go. So that person told me, have you ever been to Kerala? Kerala for, you know, Kerala is very famous for Ayurvedic massage. Maybe it might help out your hubby. Did you ever try out? So I said, no. He said, there is a hospital there. I'll give you the details. So when we were thinking where to go, and this person mentioned that you should go there, this couple snapped his finger and he said, this is where God wants to take you. Go. And so we came down to Kerala thinking we will be here for some time and then going back to, you know, these are our human plans that we make. And we were at Kottakkal in Kerala and this Ayurvedic hospital and we tried out the massage therapy and all that. But how God worked there, every evening we started singing that hallelujah, which was there, you know, remaining in me, which I'd heard that tune. So every evening we started singing there. Then during the first 2 weeks, you know, they put you up on some particular medication with my husband, where they will first detoxify your body. So his stomach got worked up. And more than 25, 30 times, and you know, when he's bedridden, so, you know, it's so difficult for him. And for me also to, you know, to clean him up. And so I was tired. I was really fatigued. He also got tired. He felt so weak. So in the evening, I had no option but to call for a doctor. So when I called for the doctor, look at how God worked. He happened to be a Catholic doctor. And this Catholic doctor, just 1 month before we come in, he has come into this hospital. And he saw our names, you know, before he comes to meet us. you know, he just read what is the history, you know, what is the case history of this patient. So he saw Hiran Metta. So he said, okay. But when he came, he saw the Bible there. So he was taken back. How come they have a Bible when they are, you know, the names don't match with, they are not Catholics, but they are not Christians. So he asked us that, how do you have, how come you are reading the Bible? I said, no, we are just praying. So he was very happy. Okay, they are in safe hands. You know, he's thinking to himself like that. Now he's a man of God. He's a man of prayer. He's a Jesus youth member.
Okay.
And he went home and he started praying. The Lord told him, send them for a retreat. Tell this couple to go for a retreat.
So till here, you have still not reconciled the fact that you wanted to accept Jesus fully, leaving out Krishna. You're still, you know, battling that.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. That's, of course, that is there. But, you know, after I prayed that prayer, I never paid much attention to, you know, whether it's Krishna or Christ.
Just
I just, because of course things were, life was in a very,
sure.
You know, the way, the events that took place. So I was trying to handle, you know, all these affairs. Anyway, so when I came there, so this doctor, you know, when the Lord told him that, you know, ask this couple to go for a retreat. And so he comes the next day just to inquire. But actually, on the back of his mind, he wants to tell us about the retreat. He said, have you ever been for a retreat? He's asking us that. And for me, the word retreat is a very new word because I just know there's a hotel called The Retreat in Bombay. So I was thinking, I said, maybe it's some hotel, maybe something to do with, you know, some spa massage or God knows what's what. Because, you know, Kerala is famous for all this. But then in the evening time as we were praying, you know, the Lord started ministering to us and the Lord told me, I got that impression in my heart. He's telling me, I want you to go for the retreat. So I told my husband, we need to go. And he would every time, you know, just, you know, set me aside telling me that, you know, you get too carried away by what people say. And he's saying, how can I just, I need so much of medical facilities. How can you take me there and... we can't work this all out. Let us see about it later. First, let us just finish this treatment. Just 2.5 months we are there and, you know, our finances are depleting. And we had a lot of other, we are contacting the couple back home. And you think things are not so good at Bombay. You need to continue staying there. I said, how long can we continue with this hospital? The charges and who's going to pay? So... we in our human mind are thinking maybe we will take a rental flat there for 2-3 months. By then things in Bombay will get better. So I even went down and saw some small little apartments. I was finalizing with that, that apartment.
Mm.
But in the evening, I get this, you know, strong inspiration. I want you to go for the retreat. So I told my hubby, we need to go. Next day, he's saying, okay, we shall see. We will think about that later. Next day, I'm going down to finalize that apartment. I don't meet that person. Again in the evening. And then the Lord calls me by name. Falguni, I command you, go for the retreat.
How did it happen? When you were praying?
Yeah, when we were praying. When we were singing that hallelujah. You know, eventually we started singing hallelujah for 2 hours. Because every evening from after 6, there is just nothing to do. 8 o'clock dinner will come in. So we really don't know what to do. How do we spend our time? And we don't have smartphones then. So what do we do? So we were only singing hallelujah. And then we would just spend quiet moments praying and, you know, reflecting of what maybe we read in during the day, the word, the Bible. And there he called me by name and he said, Falguni, I command you, go for the retreat. And he gives me a date. You know, this is something very unusual for me, this experience that I got. That he tells me, and I know it was not that my mind talking to me. I know it is the, you know, God telling me in my inner self, telling me that I want you to do this. I just want you to do this. And he gives me a date and he tells me 9th July will be the last day. This was on the 2nd of July I received this message. 9th July will be the last day you will be in this hospital. You will go for the retreat. So I told my husband, I'm not going to listen to you. I'm going. And then I tried to figure out what is this retreat all about. And I asked a doctor, and the doctor came in and I asked him, so what is this retreat that you are referring about? So he told me it's a week, you know, 6 days prayer service and all that. I said, so then, okay, I go for the retreat, then what do I do? So he's saying, yeah, you go for, and then if you want, you can do one more week. I said, but then what do I do afterwards? So my mind is only trying to calculate and, you know, evaluate everything is okay, my future will be okay. Because things back home are still not good and I need to, because this retreat is also, like, this is at Kotakal and he tells me the retreat is, it's around, this place is around 4 hours. So I said, I cannot come back. So then what do I do? And then I miss out on this apartment which I'm fixing up. All of these thoughts that were coming in my mind. But this doctor told me, see, if he's your shepherd, you've read Psalm 23, if he's your shepherd, he will lead you to pastures green. He knows which is your green pasture. You don't need to search for it. It is his duty. You just need to follow him. So you follow him. And that instilled some deep faith in me. I said, yes, God will take care of my future. So we both just left, came down here, 9th of July. Truly, we were here. And we came down here and we started attending retreats 1 week and 2 weeks and things went on. I never understood where time just, you know, went by and how the word has actually started working in our lives. And we were so open to the word. We were so open. I had no blocks as to that I'm listening to, you know, I'm at a total different background in, as regards my faith setup and all that. But again, after 2-3 months, I heard once one video which was, you know, first being telecasted here. It has one background music wherein a flute is being played. When I heard that flute, suddenly I got thoughts of Krishna. And then I asked, I said, where is Krishna now? So I asked, I said, where are you now? And then I said, God, where are you now? Again those same thoughts came up in my mind. Where are you, God? Then he's saying, every time you're asking me to show yours, you know, to reveal myself to you. And so I've brought you to this place. I reveal myself to you. So it was then I started understanding. Then again after 6 months, I got again some faith crisis. Who is Jesus? Is he really God? Or he says he's the Son of God. He's saying the Father is greater than me. And at times he says, I and the Father are one. So who is Jesus? He thinks, what a mystery. And I started reading the Bible. By then I had really started, you know, Bible was a deep attraction for me. I would take hours and hours and I would sit down with the Bible. I would just read and read and read, whether I understand or not. But something was drawing me to read that.
Yeah.
And I started reading and reading. And I just searched up the scriptures to know who Jesus is. But I never got an answer. I know he's saying, I'm Alpha, I'm Omega, I'm the way, the truth and the life, all of that. But it didn't give me that understanding of truly who Jesus is. Is he really God? So, a question mark to me. And then I heard Father Matthew saying, I also had faith crisis. You know, and every time you have a faith crisis, God is allowing something. Because he wants to deepen your conviction. So, doubt can be from the evil one, but God will turn that doubt also to our advantage. So, then I still started. One day I was reading the passage of Gospel of John, chapter 8. And the Pharisee is asking, tell us who you are. He's saying, my works will prove who I am. Then he's saying, Abraham, your forefather Abraham wanted to see one day. You know, so when the Pharisee says, Abraham, he's saying, you're not even 50. You're not even 50. Then how can you say that? And then Jesus says in John 8:58, he says, I truly tell you, before Abraham was, I am. And that struck me. Yeah, I said, he's talking about past tense and then he's talking about present tense. You know, before Abraham was, I am. And then I started reflecting, who can talk like this? Who can talk about, you know, past tense? And then he's talking, even in that past, he's talking present tense. I said, only God can do that. because He is the same yesterday, today and forever.
Mm. I'm excited to know, like, when did your conviction really, you know, strengthen and you left Krishna and you accepted Jesus?
My conversion was not like Saul becoming Paul. Yeah. No overnight conversion. Gradually, slowly and steadily, He just captivated my heart.
Mm. And when did you get baptized, Falguni?
Oh, that was 2004 we came here, but 2009 we got baptized. Mm. The baptism was not something that I always wanted to get baptized, and I had expressed my desire in 2005 itself. I had told the fathers that I also want to be a part of the, you know, I want to be a member of the church. But then, during those days, I remember Father George telling me, "I want you to grow in faith. I want you to deepen your faith." So I accepted it, thinking that this is how God wants to lead me. And I left it there. And years went by. We just remained and we were growing in the Word, and slowly and steadily we started even ministering in little ways. In 2009, I remember it was in January that one Sunday morning I get up and I said, "God, I want you to talk to me directly, Lord. Please give me some word. I know that this word is only for me and me alone. So Lord, when I go for Mass, Lord, you will give me a direct message. And I asked for a sign. I want a word from you." And I sat there, I said, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening, Lord, I want a word from you." And one brother gets up to read the first reading. And in the first reading, the thing was, that was the day of the feast of the conversion of St. Paul, Saul becoming Paul. So it mentioned there, "It is high time you get baptized."
Wow.
And that was like a little jolt for me. I said, "Is he talking to me?" And in the chapel, everybody got up to take communion, to receive communion. I was the only one who did not receive communion. So I knew it was for me. And then I said, "If you are telling me this, you will make a way. I will not do anything. You will make a way." I said, "If you are my shepherd, you make the way for me. Huh? You said I will go ahead of you and I will level down mountains. So you do what you have to do. If you want to come in me, so you will make the way." So then the word that I started receiving, "I will take away your heart of stone and I will give you a heart of flesh and I will sprinkle waters." Every word is only about baptism. And so I knew baptism is, you know, much sooner than I expect. And truly, one afternoon, I get a knock at the door and I open up the door and I see Brother A.M. Matthew, you know, a real man of God who just passed away a few days ago. He comes to me and he's saying, "You are getting baptized." Yeah. He comes to me and he's saying, "You are getting baptized." And I said, "How come suddenly he's talking to me?" He was sitting in his room and suddenly he's just thinking, you know, he's our spiritual mentor. And he was thinking to himself, "Why aren't these two children getting baptized?" He went down and spoke to Father George. He went down and spoke to Father Augustine. "These two children should get baptized." He said, "We have no problem if they want to get baptized." So he said, "I'm telling you, you are getting baptized."
Wow.
So it was so much, it was the Lord wanting to come into us, you know, we becoming a part of Him and He abiding in us and we abiding, you know, more than we longing for the Lord longs for us.
And do you remember the first time when you received the body and blood of Jesus?
That's where all this happened. When he said, "You're getting baptized," in a week's time, baptism took place. So it was that week, and then Father Augustine called us to his room and then he's saying, "You know, you are specially chosen people because you will get 5 sacraments together. Baptism and confession considered done."
Okay.
So, you know, and confirmation, Holy Communion. And he's saying, "We are going to be... Your marriage also will be sanctified, so you will also have matrimony."
Yeah.
So 5 sacraments and all the fathers of divine were there. It was a real a day of grace for both of us.
And you've been ministering in Divine for the past 14 years, right, Falguni?
Yeah, now 13 years. 2005, I started my ministry here. Yeah.
I really wanted to, you know, do this interview because there are a lot of people who, you know, get discouraged, depressed when suffering comes their way. And I think your story is something which can give strength to all the people who are going through, you know, difficult times.
The way of Christ is the way of the cross. We have a devotion of the way of the cross. But we don't have to have it as a devotion. Rather, we need to live up that devotion.
So, is there one thing that you would like to say to the people who are going through struggles and...
Suffering itself is a mystery. But as I have understood it now, there are so many reasons that can be, you know, attributed for suffering. And you cannot just pinpoint that this is the reason for suffering. But all said and done, if you are in the Lord, it is only to beautify you more, to brand you more into His image, and to get you closer to Him. Of late, because of the floods, we went through some real tough crisis with His health issues and all. And I was so much struggling. I was questioning God and I was questioning so many things. I never got answers. And then I went in for confession because I was so disturbed and so, you know, upset about this all thing, that the way things were going. And when I went to that father, the father is telling me, you know, my child, you should pray that God gives you more suffering. I said, Father, please. He said, no, you are so close to God and God wants you more closer to Him. And that's why you continue praying that you go through this crucible of suffering more and more. So that you become totally, you know, no more I who lives, but Christ who lives in me. So you will have that experience.
You know, sitting here listening to your story one-on-one, you know, I think, you know, it's a real privilege for me. Because as you are sharing, I'm so inspired and I can relate to my own things which are happening in my own life. So thank you for taking the time.
Thank you. God bless you too.
Yeah.